Okay, so let me call some names.
Ruby.
I'm gonna call the names.
Everybody.
That wasn't you, Ruby?
Was Ruby.
Ruth. Ally.
Ally?
Ruth.
Ruth, Ally. Okay, I'm gonna call you names. If you don't hear your name, please let me know you're there. Javon, Penny, Gaida, Elizabeth, Bakery, Lisa, Janice, Stephanie, Mike, Love, Ruby, Ally.
Uhuru, Herdosia.
Herdosia.
Uhuru, Kitty.
Kitty.
Anna.
Anna. Uhuru, Dulce.
Uhuru, Comrade.
Uhuru.
Maureen.
Maureen. Okay. Okay, all right, I'm gonna. Uhuru, who just came on, please?
Uhuru, this is Unique. This is Unique again. I got disconnected.
Okay.
Uhuru, this is Jackie.
This is Olivia, DC.
Olivia.
Uhuru.
Uhuru. What is your name, Sean?
Say again?
Could you say your name? Is it Sean?
Sean, coming in from San Bruno, California.
Sean, can you mute? Is that you? Could you mute your phone? Yeah, I'm gonna call it over again. But when I'm calling it, then somebody else is coming, so I'm gonna, at the end of the whole thing, I just call it. Get it straight.
And just school this crap.
Yeah, I know. For you it is, it's too bad. You never learn how to do cursing. Oh, well.
Y'all lied. Y'all know that, right? People hear y'all.
Well, they should know that Ozzy doesn't know how to read cursive.
Oh, KK.
Hurricane fan.
Hurricane fan.
Oh, everybody.
Got a voice that wakes the dead. All right. I have Elizabeth, Bakery, Lisa, Janice, Stephanie, Mike Love, Ruby, Ally, Herdosia, Kitty, Gazi, Ona, Maureen, Unique, Daphne, Olivia, Sean, okay, Finn. You didn't hear your name? Sound up. Who just came? Akile.
Star.
Star.
Pete.
Pete. Oh. 6. C06, you want to start?
Yeah, I'm ready.
All right, I'm just going to do one more roll call and we're going to get started. So I'm going to start from Bakri. I know Elizabeth is there and everybody is before that, but Bakri, Lisa, Janice, Stephanie, Mike Love, Ruby, Ali, Herdoja, Kitty, Gazi, Ona, Maureen, Unique, Daphne, Livia, Sean, Kayfin, Akile, Star, and Pete. Is that it? Everybody heard their name.
All right, Uhuru. Welcome to the study, everyone. I'm Javon. I'm the director of AgriProp, and we are currently, due to having an increase in people coming into the into our party and NPDEM and other organization, other organizations, political education began as a weekly political education organized by AgriProp to educate our forces as African internationalism or African internationalism. Currently, as the sessions continue to grow, we are forced to organize the process for more effectiveness and efficiency. Upcoming weeks, the PE will be transformed. So just stay on the lookout. We are trying to gain more organization. People from around the world are joining in, so you can live. It's now on YouTube. You can go to YouTube right this instant, and you can join into the process on Uhuru TV. One word, Uhuru TV, and it is the Sunday political study. All right. So, just want to give you a little little understanding of how we're going to work this as far as the question and answer. So when Chairman starts to talk, we need everybody to be on mute. Everybody will mute themselves. And then as we go on, when Chairman asks for questions or any comments, you may unmute yourself and then be and then ask a question. At the end of the chairman's lecture, before the questions and answers, we will ask those who came on late and did not go through the roll call to identify themselves. This is only for those who did not go through the roll call. After the question and answer and the study is over, please remain on the line for some brief information from Comrade Gazi. And we'd like to thank you for being a part of the Sunday political education conducted by Chairman Omali Ishitella. And I am Javon G from the AgriProp department. And this is now Chairman Omali Ishitella speaking on African internationalism versus Pan-Africanism. Uhuru.
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 Uhuru. Well, this presentation is taken from, is it One Africa, One Nation, the book. And it is a presentation that's about 10 years old. It came from a study, a meeting, conference that we...
Can I
please mute. Everyone, please mute.
It's a conference that was conducted in London in 2005 in the process of building the African Socialist International, which is the international African People Socialist Party that's established in various places around the world. I'm going to try to expedite this process, but I think it's really important to point out that most of the studies that we've done and that we do, including this study, attempts to take us out of some kind of purely abstract place. And the studies and critical issues that we're dealing with happen within the context of trying to solve the problems of the revolution. The African People's Socialist Party is a revolutionary organization. And a reason that we would be doing this study, as has been pointed out, responds to the growing number of people who are being attracted to the African People's Socialist Party, to the Uhuru movement. And it also is a part of the struggle that we're making to recruit people directly into the revolutionary process through the party of one of our organizations. So I'm going to go ahead and start with this presentation that was made, as I said, in 2005 in London, England, at a conference to build the African Socialist International. This was during a time when we were having regular annual conferences, in fact, in London, trying to bring together Africans from throughout the world who could agree to participate in making and building the kind of organization that we understand is necessary in order to win our freedom. We've been convinced a long time ago in the African People's Socialist Party that our freedom will not come for us within these borders that have been created by white power imperialism, that actually the struggle for our freedom as a people has run into its limitations as long as we try to win our freedom within these borders. I say these borders, I mean whether we are in places like what is now known as the United States or throughout the Caribbean, the Americas, Europe, even, and of course in Africa, where artificial borders were created at gunpoint to divide up Africa and parcel it out to different, and parcel it out to different, parcel it out to different white countries and people. So we've been engaged in building the African Socialist International. And one of the contending political positions or opinions or concepts that has been out there has been the concept of Pan-Africanism. At one time, even we in the African People's Socialist Party considered ourselves some variation of Pan-Africanism. That was wrong then, is wrong now. And what I want to do, and which is the reason that we actually had to deal with this question of Pan-Africanism versus African internationalism, or African internationalism versus Pan-Africanism, because it was a contending and continues to be some kind of continuing concept, a contending concept. So this is what we were dealing with in 2005 in London during this conference to build the African Socialist International that was attended by African people from various places from throughout the world and in the United States as well. And from throughout, when I say throughout the world, specifically from throughout Europe, I think that conference may have had Africans who were living in Portugal even, or Africans from South Africa, from various places in the United States, Europe, etc. Uhuru Amafrika. Amafrika is plural for Mafrika, Mafrika, Mu Africa. It just means Africans. Amafrika is it just means Africans in many of the Bantu languages of Africa. We want to remind ourselves of the significance of having discussions about theory, because most of us tend to believe that theory is something best left to intellectuals. And part of what we want to do with this discussion today, we want people to have some kind of general understanding of what philosophy, the need for any oppressed people to have our own philosophy. We want people to know, have a general understanding of what philosophy is, And there's some specific individuals like Harry Hayward, who at one point was called a Black Bolshevik, who was very active in the 1920s, who became the go-to person for the Communist Party USA, and subsequently, even up until this point, for people who try to represent a contending world, a contending view of around the African nation. Blaise Diagne, who is another name that should be familiar with. We hope that, well, an outcome of this where people will be familiar with those names. People should understand the significance of the UNIA as an anti-imperialist world organization or presence, Universal Negro Improvement Association. The origin of the whole Black Belt South theory of the Black nation, people should know something about that coming out of this discussion. And of course, the limitations of Pan-Africanism and why we call ourselves and believe that the way forward is African internationalism. So we're saying that it takes us into the discussion of theory, philosophy. In colonial education systems, we are often intimidated and led to believe that it is not worth paying attention to philosophy and to theory. And in the real world, however, all of us have a philosophy, although that philosophy is usually the philosophy of the ruling class. The ruling class, through its educated and thinking representatives, has created a systematized philosophy. And philosophy is about understanding the world and our place and future in it. Philosophy is our worldview. Philosophy is about understanding the world and our place and future in it. Philosophy is our worldview. Even if we don't recognize we have a philosophy, we do. The white ruling class is pumping its worldview into our communities all the time. And their worldview is foreign, hostile, and alien to our interests. In every African community that I am familiar with, there's a church on nearly every corner. The churches are one way that the ruling class projects its worldview into our communities. There are other methods for doing this as well. The cartoonist who writes the comic strip that you enjoy reading in the newspaper generally projects the worldview of the white ruling class. The movies that you watch project this philosophy. Professors teach you this philosophy. Their worldview is always there. For philosophy to be meaningful to us, it must explain the world in which we live and our place in it. It has to do that with some kind of accuracy, because we have to find our way out of our oppressive conditions. All philosophy is class philosophy, because we live in a class society. Since we live in a society that is dominated by the white ruling class, which is the bourgeoisie, the philosophy that affects us all the time is the philosophy of the white ruling class. That's true even when it's coming from your Negro preacher. For us to be a free people, we need our own philosophy. It is necessary to have a revolutionary force that has the capacity to create a philosophy and systematize it from the perspective of the oppressed African working class and poor peasantry. Our philosophy must represent our needs and aspirations, our conditions, and our place in the world. That is the only way we can move forward. Some people say that philosophy does not represent class interests. They say it's above class, it is innocent. And this is something that you might even hear from universities or people who like to position themselves as all-seeing, all-knowing, and what have you. And there's this world view, there's this way of apprehending and understanding the world that's above the actual relationships that people exist in the world. It's free and separate from it. That this place, this thing that just lives someplace out in the world and people's ideas, that has no class content. And that's not true. The white ruling class has an absolute material interest in falsifying history. who say that some people say that philosophy does not represent class interest. But we are saying that the white ruling class has an absolute material interest in falsifying history. It must falsify history as a condition for holding us as an oppressed people. For the oppressed people to be free, we have to struggle to find and reveal the truth. We can say with some certainty that the struggle to find the philosophical worldview of the oppressed working class requires a search for the truth. We have an interest in being able to free ourselves. Therefore, we must have a philosophy that contributes to that effort. We have an objective interest in destroying the social system as it really is and creating a world that will facilitate our liberation. And the basic point I want to make here is that for those people who argue that philosophy is without class content, it does not serve any purpose, that you can't say that philosophy will have a class content, or what makes your philosophy better or different from your worldview from the ruling class, that all philosophy is philosophy. And what we're saying, that's not true. We're saying that if philosophy is truly to represent our understanding of the world, our place and destiny in it, and that's all philosophy is, then there must be a class content in it, because we live in a system, we all live in the world, and the world is, the relations in the world characterized by class and national oppression. So we say that that the ruling class has to falsify reality, falsify history. It is a means by which the ruling class controls the oppressed, where the oppressed must necessarily find the truth. So to say that we make a distinction between the philosophy of the oppressed and the oppressor is because the oppressor has an objective interest, a real material interest in falsifying history. He cannot keep the people oppressed without doing that, whereas the oppressed must discover truth as a condition for winning freedom. If you find people who claim to represent the oppressed and they too engage in falsifying or obscuring reality and the truth, then you can say that is a philosophy that they represent that is a philosophy of the bourgeoisie and not a philosophy of the oppressed. Because the oppressed cannot be free without discovering the truth. And that's the point that we would make. So we say that that this means that we have to grapple with ideas. We are in a contest, a battle of ideas. Because if the oppressed do not have a worldview that represents our own interests, we borrow the worldview of the oppressor. And we don't do this necessarily intentionally. And I found myself having done this over a period of time. And people who think they come to this discussion of freedom, from some innocent place, they think that every idea that says we are for freedom is equal to every other idea. When the oppressor says freedom, the oppressor means something absolutely different from the oppressed. And you can't use the oppressor's ideas about freedom to serve the struggle for liberation. And so if we do not have our own philosophy, what we end up doing is borrowing from the philosophy of the oppressor. We spend all this time trying to solve our problems using the philosophy, the ideology, the worldview of the oppressors of the world. We just dig ourselves deeper and deeper into a hole. In the U.S., in particular, but in Africa and around the world, as well, our friends, in quotes, especially white liberals and so-called socialist economists, tell us that we want to unite and liberate Africa because we've reached a place of hopelessness. They say that of those of us who say that Africa is our homeland and Africa must be united and liberated, and that we have to reconnect, reestablish our connection with Africa, they say that's hopelessness. They say that when you see movements of black people here and around the world who talk about going to back to Africa. It is some place that we've come to some kind of hopelessness. They paint it as a picture of having run into some kind of wall, philosophically and politically, and it's a sort of a step backwards into the past. It's automatically romanticizing a past. In fact, they even call it creating a past because from their perspective, from their worldview, it is absolutely insane for us to be talking about Africa. From their perspective, Africa is going backwards in history, reverting to savagery, and all those other fabrications about us that they accept as reality. For them, the most significant place to be in the whole world is with white people. Theirs is a worldview that is based on the material relationship that they have to us and all our resources. They are not cognizant of the consequences of having stolen all our wealth and riches. Europeans have now have all the wealth, and Africa and African people have all the poverty and backwardness. White people can't understand why those of us in North America and other places would want to leave these wonderful people and go back to Africa. They see it as hopelessness. They say that we are supposed to spend our lives struggling to get them to like us enough that they would share their lifestyle with us. This is the worldview of the oppressor. So here you are talking about going back to Africa or going to Africa, uniting, liberating Africa. So they say, well, they've come to this point of hopelessness. These are the people who love us who say this, by the way. These are not the bad guys. These are the good guys who say they love us. And they reprimand the bad white people by saying, look what you've done to the Negroes by creating this sense of hopelessness that they want to go back to Africa. Or they say this to African leaders that, look, you know, you're trying to lead your people into this place of backwardness when you have all this wonderful stuff before you, being with the white people in America. The reality is that it is normal and natural for African people to want to be with African people and in Africa. It would be abnormal for us not to want to be there. Being with Africans is being with our family, being with our brothers and sisters. It is also normal for us not to want to be in these circumstances that we face as a consequence of having been kidnapped and separated from our mothers, brothers and sisters. Africa is not just an abstract concept. Africa is the place from which African people were taken against our will. The point is that Africa is the place from which we were taken and introduced to the most abject and horrible conditions of existence. This is the place, this being left, coming from Africa, brought us into a captivity, a dispersal, poverty, oppression, so that all of the wealth and resources that's being exploited in Africa today benefits somebody else, and our Africa does not benefit us at all. And so we are crazy because we want to reattach to the Africa that they're stolen, that they continue to loot today, etc. Historically, there has never been a time subsequent to the attack on Africa that Africans have not tried to return to Africa. There has never been a time since we were kidnapped and taken away from Africa that we haven't tried to get back. There has always been a tendency in our communities to try to get back to our homeland. Africa is the only place in the world where we've known freedom. And you wouldn't find Africans trying to get back to Africa if Africa had been horrible to us. That's why white people don't want to go back to Europe, because they left Europe fleeing horrors and terrors and stuff like that. But Africa is the only place that we've ever known real freedom. There has always been a history of resistance, of people fighting back and not just escaping from slavery, but actually trying to go back to Africa. Ships were captured by Africans The Amistad is an example of that. In 1839, Africans took over the slave ship Amistad in an attempt to return to Africa. The most outstanding heroic examples of dispersed attempts to reconnect ourselves to Africa are in Liberia and Sierra Leone. And by the way, the Africans who led the Amistad resistance was an African taken from the place that they now call Sierra Leone. These movements to get back to Africa have been given certain characterizations and names. Sometimes they were called African colonization schemes. At some junctures in the 18th century, I don't think that this is right when it says the 18th century, but the term Pan-Africanism began to be used, although there was no practical ability organizationally or politically to actually implement Pan-Africanism. I mean, the term Pan-Africanism may have been used, but it doesn't seem to me that have been 1700s. It doesn't seem likely. The most outstanding example of African people trying to build on an all-African movement was the movement led by Marcus Garvey and his organization, the Universal Negro Improvement Association, or UNIA. The Garvey movement was not just about Africans outside of Africa attempting to return to Africa. The UNIA was based all over the world, including in Africa, and had a membership and following that approximated 11 million people. And I should say of the UNIA that there were members and followers of the UNIA who were in India, Australia, and places like that, other places where Black people exist and have existed under oppression for quite a while. Garvey's movement was really significant and outstanding because it was based in the African workers and poor people everywhere. The movement had branches in Cuba, Nicaragua, and what is now what they now refer to as Namibia. It was in South Africa, Jamaica, the US, England, and many other places. The Garvey movement and the program of the Universal Negro Improvement Association was an all-African effort. It was extraordinary. In 1920, Garvey held a convention in Madison Square Garden in New York that was attended by more than 25,000 people from around the world. In fact, actually, this is estimated from 25,000 to 50,000 people attended that. And the reason it is not clear is because there were so many people that they could not be contained in Madison Square Garden. So thousands of people were outside listening to and participating in the convention through speakers that had been installed for their participation. There were so many people that they couldn't even get into the building. Speakers had to be set up so that people outside could listen to the proceedings. They had elections and created a provisional government. They created our own flag. This is independence. And I think that's important for a number of reasons, but I won't elaborate on that right now. They created a military contingent of the African League with African people in military uniforms. They created the Black Cross nurses. They created all the features they could that would represent an independent government. They began to unify an economy of African people everywhere. They created shipping lines and industry. In 1919, Garvey had created the Black Star Line, a steamship line. People criticized him, saying that he bought bad ships, but he bought ships. It was a steamship line designated to effect trade between African people all over the world. Garvey wasn't begging from anyone. Africans all over the world put their pennies, nickels, and dimes into these enterprises. When he launched the first ship in New York, more than 100,000 Africans from everywhere came to watch our ship. That was in 1919. We haven't had a shipping line since. That might have been 1920, really. He did it without the internet and other technology. So 100,000 people came to watch the launching of this ship. This was incredible. And yet, we are crazy for wanting to be associated with Garvey from the perspective of the white ruling class and those people who think like the white ruling class. That's their worldview. Even as Garvey was doing these things, the African petty bourgeoisie was assailing him from every front. The assault was led by none other than W.E.B. Du Bois, who was the NAACP, who was with the NAACP. Du Bois actually went to the Attorney General of the United States requesting a ship to use to enter into the Black Star Line as a means of destroying it. So Garvey goes out among the African people and creates a steamship line. And Du Bois goes to the government and say, give me a ship so that I can use it. Goes to the government for a ship that he can use to help destroy the shipping line that Black people had purchased through the Universal Negro Improvement Association, the Black Star Line. Du Bois went as an emissary to Liberia to persuade the Liberian government to destroy the project that Garvey's movement was establishing there. Du Bois helped to expose the fact that Garvey had intentions of taking over the government of Liberia because of the way that African government in Liberia treated the African workers. Garvey didn't call himself a communist. In fact, he fought the communists, just like I have fought them all over the US and other places. We call them Ku Klux communists or ideological imperialists, because they are just like the other white people. They try to determine what it means for us to be free. To them, we are just some kind of auxiliary force to facilitate the emancipation of the industrial working class, which by definition is white. Garvey fought all those who attacked him and his program, including W.E.B. Du Bois, along with the U.S. government and imperialism all around the world. Two things will show you who Garvey was. One, that was after the victory of the Russian Revolution, Garvey sent telegrams of congratulations to Lenin and Trotsky. And I think that's important because Lenin and Trotsky were recognized around the world as the leaders of the Russian Revolution, the Communist Revolution. Second, Garvey's base was the African working class all around the world. In fact, that's another reason why Du Bois attacked Garvey. Du Bois had a philosophy that he called the talented 10th. He believed that the top, most educated 10% of the African population would, with permission of the U.S. bourgeoisie, lead and have the authority over the rest of us. Du Bois was a neo-colonialist, if I ever heard of one. Du Bois created the Pan-Africanist Congress for the purpose of assaulting the Garvey movement. I think that's really important for us to understand, that the Pan-Africanist Congress was created in 1919. That's when they had their first meeting, and that was a part of the attack on the Garvey movement. The Pan-African Congress was an organization of African intellectuals and petty bourgeoisie. This was the talented 10. The man who facilitated the first Pan-African Congress in 1919 in France was an African from Senegal named Blaise Diagne. During the period of French colonialism, Diagne was a member of the French Parliament. During the first imperialist war, he went all over West Africa organizing African people to fight on the side of the French. He did this even as we were under colonial domination. As a condition for being able to hold the Pan-Africanist Congress in Paris, they had to agree not to criticize French colonialism. And that, this is really important, because when we said he was a member of parliament, we're talking about even as France held Senegal, where he was from, under colonial domination, he was a member of the Parliament of France, the same France that used Black people from all around the world to fight as soldiers to fight against the Vietnamese, who France had also colonized. Diagne was a facilitator of that process. That was why Du Bois and his cohorts and the NAACP that Garvey characterized as a national association for the advancement of certain people. Garvey understood the class question. We are talking about Pan-Africanism. We are not talking about an abstract idea that has no practical implications and manifestation. Pan-Africanism actually came into existence as an attack on the Garvey movement. It was created in 1919 by 1925. Garvey, they helped to facilitate the process that had Garvey jailed. 1923, Garvey, I think, was jailed and then kicked out of the country in 1925. The Pan-African Congress was essentially a gathering of middle class and petty bourgeois intellectuals. If you read their proceedings, you find ongoing attacks on Garvey, whom they all wanted to get rid of. But Garvey had the most effective international movement in the world. The Garvey movement was larger than the Third Communist International. And I mentioned the Third International, Communist International, the Third Congress of the Communist International, because many people who call themselves leftist communist revolutionaries recognize the validity of the Communist International that was led by V.I. Lenin at the time, and was supposedly connected to communists all around the world. It was the Communist International. But Garvey's movement was larger than the Third Communist International. But as typical, has not been recognized as this powerful organization, as this powerful anti-imperialist organization. So even as people would write glowing things about the Communist International and its implication for the struggle around the world, nobody recognizes the Garvey movement in that context. In fact, one of the biggest problems we have are Garveyites, are people who claim Garvey, who do more to besmirch, in my estimation, the significance of Marcus Garvey, even than the overtly anti-Garvey forces, because they mystify who Garvey was. They make him some otherworldly force, the prophet, before his times and stuff like that, when in fact Garvey built this magnificent anti-imperialist, worldwide anti-imperialist movement. And if you read some of the documents, and I have them, where FBI informants were reporting to their handlers, they would send in reports on a regular basis, and they would talk about how revolutionaries from throughout the world would come to report to Garvey, you know, from China, from Japan, from, well, I don't remember Japan, but certainly from China and from throughout the Americas. They would all come to report to Garvey on a regular basis. This is in their statements. Garvey's newspaper, The Negro World, was the unofficial organ of the Sandinista Revolution in Nicaragua during the 1920s. It was written in three languages. The Garvey movement was in Cuba and in Namibia and in Azania. Ho Chi Minh attended Garvey meetings in New York City. The entire communist movement attacked Garvey and the entire African petty bourgeoisie, not just Du Bois, but other Negroes as well. So, you know, virtually every meaningful force that we are familiar with was impacted by some way in the African world by Garvey and the Garvey movement. From Nkrumah, who said the most important document thing he had ever read was The Philosophy and Opinions of Marcus Garvey. And there were others, you know, Ho Chi Minh attended Garvey meetings on a regular basis. So he had a powerful impact on the world, and that impact is being manifested even as we have this discussion right now. The significance of Marcus Garvey is with us. So we say that one of these Negroes.
Please mute. Somebody please mute.
Let me ask. Mute, please. Please mute your phone. Mute your phone. Mute. Please, thank you. Mute your phone, please.
Whoever got the television.
Whatever you got, mute your phone. Please mute. One of these Negroes was Harry Haywood, who was a member of the Communist Party USA during the period of Garvey. Haywood wrote a book called Black Bolshevik. During the height of the Garvey movement, Garvey used to have parades in New York City in which hundreds of thousands of African workers participated. Haywood grew up in an all-white community. He walked around the Garvey movement to join the Communist Party when there were only 50 Africans in the Communist Party and millions in the Garvey movement. So, I mean, this is a real statement of the significance, I mean, who Haywood was. Haywood, he grew up, I think it was someplace in the Midwest, in an all-white, in a lily white community. And he ended up in the military. And he came out of the military the Garvey movement was raging with millions of African people in it and connected to it. Yet Haywood walked around the Garvey movement and joined the Communist Party USA when there were only 50 Negroes in the whole organization, which is a statement, you know, of his worldview. At the meeting of the Third International, the Communist Party had to grapple with what they call the national question. And this was something that communists throughout the world were talking about. It wasn't just related to Africans in this country, but what they characterized as a national question, because this whole phenomenon of the nation is something that came into full force as a political reality, especially in the 19th century, and contributed to what many people saw as the wars that of the first imperialist wars and et cetera. And so this question of national question, what is the nation, and the implications that this phenomenon of nations, you know, how does that involve or influence the struggle for communism, socialism? This is how they were dealing with the question. And the founding of the Communist Party USA in 1919, one of the first issues that they had to contend with was the movement of Marcus Garvey. In fact, the first position that the Communist Party USA had on African people in this country revolved around an assault on Marcus Garvey, because they had defined the world, their worldview, perceived the world again with white people in the center, and with the whole notion of the industrial working class being the critical mover of history, and that African people in the United States had to see ourselves at best as some kind of auxiliary force that would facilitate the rise to power of the industrial working class. And the industrial working class of the world was white, because most of the other peoples were not trapped by industrially based capitalism, but capitalism affected us differently. And so Garvey was a fundamental problem that they had to deal with. And the Communist International became confronted with this question of the national question as it related to Black people in the United States. And I think they were looking at South Africa as well. And here you have the Communist Party, the Communist International, trying to win these thousands, these millions of African people into its ranks in the United States and other places. But the millions of African people were saying Africa for Africans, those at home and those abroad, and they were connected to the Garvey movement, and they were not considered by white people, nor did they consider themselves a part of some kind of industrial working class as their primary identity. They saw themselves primarily as Black people, Africans who were being oppressed by white people and white power. And the solution they were looking for was one that would remove that contradiction. And Garvey's movement summed that up. First, identifying the fact that Africa was our land, and that we had to fight to unify and liberate Africa, take Africa. And Garvey helped us to understand, took us out of the clouds, where people were wishing to have some kind of relationship with white people, and identified that the primary first relationship we had to have was with each other as Africans. That was the primary contradiction that was causing us problems, and with our land and our resources, and that we had to build our own economic well-being. This is where Garvey was coming from, where the others were idle dreamers and hoping that they could find a way to connect and win favor with white people and white power. Garvey was saying that we have to unite our people and create our own power. So we say that at the meeting of the Third International, the Communist Party had to grapple with what they call the national question. They could not get around the fact that millions of people were following Garvey. So they decided to address this question. In the US, the Communist Party came up with the concept of a Black Belt South. They said that Africans in the United States had been forged into a nation in the so-called Black Belt South. So they used what they characterized as a scientific process concluded that African through our oppression and enslavement in a certain section of the United States, particularly the Black Belt South, had actually been transformed into a nation that was confined to the Black Belt South. And they did not recognize the fact that our homeland had been taken away from us and we from it, which is what Africans were responding to by joining the Garvey movement. Haywood was used by the Communist Party to put forth the Black Belt South theory. I want to say that Haywood is the one who at the meeting of the Third International put forth the position, the resolution on the Black Belt South. But Haywood himself did not write it. And if you read Black Bolshevik, that Haywood wrote himself, he was opposed to the position of the Black Belt South. He was opposed to it because he didn't think Black people were a nation at all. We were just sort of dark-skinned white people and a part of the white working class. So it was a Russian. It was a young Russian in the Soviet Union who actually constructed and developed this whole theory about the Black Belt South, about Africans being from the Black Belt South. And but Haywood became the one who carried the message forward, who put the resolution out, who subsequently authored the book Black Bolshevik and many other books associated with this position, and is recognized by many, I'm gonna say many, M-I-N-I Haywoods around this country and the world as the authority on our having been forged into a new nation. In fact, I don't think it was at this conference in London, but one conference in London was really very interesting because the grandson of Blaise Diogenes presented at one of our conferences. He's a real smooth guy, lives in France. He's from Senegal, spends time in France. The workers thing is the most, and he's a very charismatic and guy. And I can't think of his name at this moment, but I will probably before the meeting is over. And he was really good in terms of just being very articulate, very, you know, charismatic and, you know, made this eloquent presentation in French. I assumed it was eloquent. It looked eloquent. And, he looked eloquent. But his position was the Black Belt South. So Diogenes' grandson, who opposed Garvey in the 1919, was at our conference opposing African internationalism, and the book that he had with him, that he based so much of what he said about African people in the United States was Harry Haywood's Black Bolshevik. I just thought that was extremely interesting. So the Communist Party culture had been treating African people as chocolate-colored white workers. Our solution was supposed to be found among the white working class. Garvey understood that the masses of African people could not satisfy our own interests and aspirations short of becoming free as a people, short of achieving national liberation. So Garvey built a movement that was rooted in the African working class. Suddenly, the Communist Party discovered that we have a nation that can be free of white folk in the Black Belt South. The Communists said the nation of the Black Belt South could function as an auxiliary to the Communist Revolution inside the United States. Then they developed a division of labor. One of the roles the Communist assigned to Africans who joined their party was to organize Africans in Africa. So all of a sudden, the Communist Party began to recognize that there was some kind of organic relationship between Africans outside of Africa and those who are in Africa. We couldn't work for us, we had to work for the Communist Party and the Communist International. And then from the US, we could go organize African people in Africa. And Garvey organizing African people in Africa, but his position is Africa for Africans, those at home and those abroad, which is entirely different from the task that was being assigned to us by the Communist Party inside this country. This isn't any different from every other missionary program that is designed to send African people, Negroes from the US into Africa to Christianize African people. We couldn't facilitate our own agenda, we had to facilitate theirs. George Patmore was a member of the African Bureau of the Communist Party on the continent of Africa. It wasn't just the continent, he was of the African Bureau. And this, you know, was, you could find it a lot in England and other places. And like a lot of Africans, Patmore later broke with the Communist Party for his own selfish reason. He wrote a book called Pan-Africanism or Communism. The 1945 gathering of the Pan-Africanist Congress in Manchester, England was different from the previous ones. And there had been some gatherings from time to time of the Pan-Africanist movement that was founded by Du Bois, that was led by Du Bois. But they were just a handful of people and officials from particular European governments who would participate in these meetings. Never were the masses involved in these meetings. Garvey movement was a massive movement. As I mentioned, in 1920, 25 to 50,000 African people attended this convention that they held in New York City, where you would find only a handful of Black intellectuals and white government officials who were attending the Pan-Africanist Congress of W.E.B. Du Bois. So up in 1945, now George Patmore has left the Communist Party and he has become a Pan-Africanist. And he became the primary organizer of the Pan-Africanist Congress that happened in Manchester, England in 1945. Now Du Bois, he got in touch with Du Bois and Du Bois became the figurehead for this thing that Patmore was leading. Du Bois had the stature, he had the history of having organized the others. And so Du Bois' name was really important for Patmore. Patmore was an organizer. He had grown up, had much of his experience in the Communist International. He knew how to organize, he was disciplined, and he had connections through the Communist International. He had connections throughout the Black world. And there was a meeting of African-based, of African-related trade unions and what have you happening in Europe. And what Patmore did was get many representatives from that trade union to come and participate in this Pan-Africanist Congress with Du Bois as the one who was supposed to be head. This is the only Pan-Africanist Congress that ever held where one, it was masses of working people were involved. It was not just a handful of intellectuals. And two, where they talked about any kind of program that had to deal with the working people. And Nkrumah was there. Garvey's widow was at this meeting in 1945 as well. And she said she was there to carry on the work of her husband. That's why she was there. And so there were other people who, this was the large meeting that they had. Kenyatta might have been there, I'm not sure. But Africans from the continent were there. And this was the first time they broke out of that narrow circle they had been working with up until that point. So we say that there were representatives from labor organizations and greater participation of the masses. Kwame Nkrumah attended this Congress. It was a larger Congress than, and they put out some rather progressive documents. Patmore contributed more to the definition of Pan-Africanism at this Congress. In Pan-Africanism or Communism, Padmore defined his own version of a neo-colonialist solution for African people. Padmore was an anti-communist, as the name of the book suggests. His book was nothing more than a cry to the imperialist powers to recognize the need for ameliorating the conditions of African people in Africa in order to keep African people from turning to communism. So this is what Padmore was doing, Pan-Africanism or communism. And Padmore was a brilliant guy. And he had collected all kinds of documentation about the conditions of Black people all around the world. He was connected in that fashion. And so he's alerting all the white rulers that that if you want to keep communism from afflicting, you know, African people in Africa and every place else, then you need to support Pan-Africanism. This is what you need to do. And that's what the book Pan-Africanism Communism was all about. And I have that book for anybody who wants to look at it, and who could, on the armed guard, come and search my library. At the Congress, Padmore and Du Bois put together pacifist nonviolent solutions. Padmore influenced Nkrumah. He worked with Nkrumah right here in London and in other places in England. They came up with a parliamentary strategy for liberalism, for liberation. It was a nonviolent, non-communist, pacifist, and parliamentary strategy. Nkrumah, in the estimation of our party, was a magnificent giant. He had an incredible vision about the possibilities of Africa and what it would take to free Africa and unify it in very practical terms. Nkrumah worked for the unification of Africa like no one else did. He died alone and isolated precisely because he was fighting for it by himself at this time. Nkrumah took up the principles of Pan-Africanism that had been developed by Du Bois and Padmore. He went back to Ghana, where he succeeded in forcing the British to capitulate and grant independence. Nkrumah called his strategy the Positive Action Campaign. It included demonstrations, boycotts, and strikes. The British conceded to Nkrumah, but there were certain issues that Nkrumah did not understand, and that lack of understanding led to his overthrow. Before being overthrown, Nkrumah did incredible things. In 1958, he pulled together forces from all around the African world that were fighting for freedom, including Robert Mangaliso Sobukwe of South Africa and Patrice Lumumba of Congo. And I say this happened in 1958 in Ghana because now this is right after Nkrumah went to power as president of Ghana. I mean, this guy really believed in uniting Africa and African people. So as soon as he got in power, and one of the most important statements he made with independence, that Ghana shall never be free until all Africa is free. That is what Nkrumah said. And then he brought Lumumba and Sobukwe and others, not just those two, but other people from throughout the continent. He set up bases for to train revolutionary forces who were still trying to win their independence and freedom in other parts of Africa. So we say that Lumumba was simply asking for amelioration of the situation in Congo until he met Nkrumah. Nkrumah told him the demand must be for independence. Nkrumah influenced Sobukwe, who built the Pan-Africanist Congress of Azania. And these were incredible forces. They used parliamentary, nonviolent, pacifist means to come to power. They took the philosophy of Pan-Africanism to Congo and South Africa. We saw the Sharpeville Massacre in March 1960, where Sobukwe was building the PAC. These forces were different from the other Pan-Africanists. They were different from Jomo Kenyatta of Kenya. Kenyatta was a Pan-Africanist too. Today, his family is among the wealthiest people in Kenya. Kenya is still dominated by white settlers who own most of the land in Kenya today. Sekou Touré of Guinea-Conakry united with Nkrumah. Patrice Lumumba and Nkrumah had actually signed an agreement that unified Congo and Ghana. These were people who believed in unifying Africa, but none of them built organizations that made the assumptions that they were going to have to fight imperialism. None of them built organizations that recognized the existence of class inside of Africa. It was only after Nkrumah was overthrown that he began to understand the question of class. That was when he wrote Class Struggle in Africa and Handbook of Revolutionary Warfare. He didn't understand the need until then because he was a Pan-Africanist. Pan-Africanism is a dead-end philosophy, notwithstanding the fact that there were Pan-Africanists who were splendid, magnificent representatives of our struggle. Pan-Africanism got Nkrumah overthrown and killed. He didn't understand the class question. When Nkrumah was overthrown, he was on his way to Vietnam. He had a whole entourage with him. He stopped in Beijing where he learned that his government was overthrown in Ghana. All of a sudden, his traveling entourage left him one by one for various reasons. The only people that stayed with Nkrumah were the people who were on staff and being paid. The whole party left, which is why the struggles to build a revolutionary party. This is why we struggle and do all the stuff internally to create the kind of organizations that's necessary to make this revolution. When Lumumba was killed by CIA with Mobutu's help, with rare exceptions, the members of his party went over to the side of Mobutu. Nkrumah and Lumumba did not build organizations to seize power, nor did they recognize the question of class. The class enemy was inside their own organization. They didn't understand these questions. Then we saw the Organization of African Unity, which was supposed to be an expression of Pan-Africanism. The OAU maintains the power of the same African petty bourgeoisie. As you look at the African world right now, you find that Africans are worse off in terms of material conditions with Pan-Africanists in power than we were before our so-called independence. I want to say something about the OAU, the Organization of African Unity, because many people hold us up as this sterling Pan-Africanist formation that brings black people together, et cetera. And there is actually a movement around the world right now to get what is now the OAU without the O, the African, they call itself the African Union now, to try to get the African Union to recognize a sixth region of black people who are not in Africa itself. And for them, this is the highest ideal of Pan-Africanism. But I wanna say that that Nkrumah, that Pan-Africanist, the OAU was founded for the same reason that the Pan-Africanist Congress was founded. The Pan-Africanist Congress was founded as an assault on the Garvey movement, and the OAU was founded because there was real concern by the imperialist power with the work that Nkrumah was doing to unite African people to liberate all and unite all of Africa. So Nkrumah was talking about the need to defeat imperialism and colonialism all over Africa, and that in order to do that, Africa must be united. There's a book, you can find it in Nkrumah, we have it. Africa must be united. And the thing about uniting Africa, he said, unless we unite Africa, we're gonna have neo-colonialism. Neo-colonialism is gonna be, and then he wrote a book on neo-colonialism, the last stage of imperialism, or the final stage of imperialism, something to that effect. So Nkrumah was trying to unite all of Africa, tear the borders down and what have you. He said, there is no future unless we do this. And then the white power forces were so concerned. You got to remember, at this time, there may have been, when Nkrumah called this meeting in 1958, there were only a handful of so-called independent African countries. And Nkrumah's Ghana was the first one that followed Liberia and Ethiopia, and I think Sierra Leone might have already, Sierra Leone may not have even been independent at this time, I'm not sure. But Nkrumah was moving to unite all of Africa under African leadership. He was talking about a single African state, a single African government. This is what Nkrumah was trying to do. And it concerned all of the imperialist powers around the world. 1957, of course, had already seen the 1950s, the whole Mau Mau struggle, the struggle of the Kenyan Land Freedom Army. And there was a whole movement that was struggling to take back Africa for Black people. And so the British and the others got together and they facilitated the development of the Organization of African Unity, of this meeting that happened in Addis Ababa on May 24th and 25th of 1963. And the objective was to get in front of Nkrumah and create this artifice that came to be known as the Organization of African Unity. They used people again, Senegal, which is under the French. They used this noted guy had been a poet, and who am I thinking about? The head of Senegal at the time, the anyway, they used him and to oppose Nkrumah, all kinds of opposition, because the split divided around those who were saying, no, we can't do this. They began to slander Nkrumah, saying that Nkrumah just wants to be the head of all the Africa. He just wants to be the president of Africa. And he planted in their brains these middle class Negroes, these puppets who have been created, that man Nkrumah just wanted to replace them with himself. It's all kind of horrible, slanderous stuff they did to Nkrumah. What's the person's name? I'm thinking.
Singhor.
Uhuru, comrade, you there? Oh, good to hear you, comrade Luese.
Yeah, I'm there.
Okay.
Yeah, who was the other name you wanted? Yeah.
Who? What other name?
Fode Diarra.
Say it again.
The grandson of Diarra. Fode.
Fode. Yeah, Fode. That's right. That was the brother who was, I was saying, the grandson of, I mispronounced. How's his last name pronounced? Not Fode, but the...
Gianni.
Yeah. He was the one I was talking about in France, 1919. So Singhor was he was just the nastiest, most involved puppet Negro. But there were others, and you should be clear on this, because some of them have good reputations in the so-called movement today. And even though they're deceased, and I'm talking about like out of Tanzania, Nyeri, Nkrumah was saying right now, he said, we must unite now. And some were saying later, and Nyeri was saying that, well, we can't do the whole thing unless we unite by regions instead of the whole Africa, et cetera. But the objective was to block Nkrumah, and they participated. And, before he died, Nyeri, goes to Ghana when the people who overthrew Nkrumah are now in power, and he makes some statement that Nkrumah was right, et cetera. So Nkrumah, tried to build this movement. And the OAU was something that they used to get in front of Nkrumah to come up with another kind of solution that gave the appearance, tried to give the appearance of uniting Africa, except the unity that they had was the unity of the African petty bourgeois neo-colonial leaders, and it protected them, and it protected the status quo, because the codification of this entity, the Organization of African Unity, included in it that the colonial borders were sacred. That the colonial borders could not be changed, that the borders that were created by the imperialists had to be there, and it demanded that no interference by any of the so-called independent states in any other independent states would be tolerated. So what they did instead was they codified in 1963, they codified what the imperialists had done in 1884 and 85. They said, shall be like this forever. And they called that African unity, when actually what it was African disunity. And they used all these forces to unite them against where Nkrumah was trying to go, which is what Garvey had been trying to take us all along. And what happened is what Nkrumah predicted, the presentation that he made on May 24th. He's saying that right now, we must leave here with a united Africa. And to do anything other than this is to portray what the masses of our people, called on us to do. And also, he recognized that what it would do was create all these separate little bailiwicks that people wanted to call countries that allow this prime minister and this president and all of these other little entities to consolidate them in power, and it gives them a stake. And now the territories that were created were entities that were necessary for the reproduction of a particular class of neo-colonial. So you needed that for their own reproduction. They can't get rid of Ghana. They can't get rid of any of these things. They have to fight to keep Africa divided in order to reproduce themselves as a social force. And Nkrumah recognized this. So they got their own armies and their own presidents and their own this and that. And every one of them is funded by white power. And there's not a single one of them that produces its own independent budget that funds what it wants to do. All of them get what they need to function as governments from what they call donor governments. White people keep it going because it facilitates the theft of our resources. This is Pan-Africanism in action. And so what happened was the OAU became this Pan-Africanist entity, and it became the umbrella neo-colonial organization that would control Africa and prevent Africa from being free. This was, as I mentioned, forces who got in front of Nkrumah. So we say that, where are we? We say people ask, can there be revolutionary Pan-Africanism? And I think that's an oxymoron. Well, it's certainly moronic. A contradiction in terms. Pan-Africanism does not have the ability to recognize the class question. Therefore, whoever wants to be a Pan-Africanist can be. Nkrumah was a communist, but I've been in London with people who call themselves Pan-Africanists who are anti-communist. So Pan-Africanist is whatever somebody who calls himself a Pan-Africanist wants to be. And that's a fundamental part of the problem. Because African internationalism requires recognize that the future belongs to the African working class, and the future is a communist future. It's a class-based leadership that's going to result in our liberation. We are at a time in history when we have to be clearer than that. The concept of Pan-Africanism is not accidental nor abstract. Marx said, quote, theory, when it grips the masses, become a material force. The Pan-Africanism liquidates the class contradiction that's killing us all over Africa and keeping us oppressed all over the world. We have to draw lines now if we're going to move forward. The African workers and poor peasants must recognize our enemy and must recognize our future. We must have our own philosophy and theory that arms the workers and masses to see that the future belongs to them. The workers and poor peasants must fight for this future. We have to have a philosophy and theory that helps the workers and peasants to free themselves from the notion that people with the most education and purest credentials are smarter than the rest of us and are supposed to lead us. If that's the kind of freedom we are going to get, I don't want to fight for it. Because of the failure of Pan-Africanism, there are places all across the African world where Africans actually are calling for the return of direct white power. I've seen that, especially in South Africa. They say things were better before the Pan-Africanists came to power. Pan-Africanism is not even a theory. It's a concept that doesn't explain our place in the world. It's a concept. that different people, depending on their own aspirations, can use to identify themselves. In fact, Nkrumah said, Pan-African is not a theory. I've heard it said that he said Pan-African is a theory, it's an aspiration. We call ourselves African internationalists. We are attempting to have a worldview that forces our capacity to be free, that mobilizes the masses of people, that explains the world in a way that's consistent with reality, not the way we wish the world to be. The reality is that society is based on class. There's no way to get around it. No matter, and we're going to talk some more in you know, upcoming days and weeks about this whole question of class, because it's another thing that has been mystified. We had serious struggles in the past with forces who talk about how the class question was the dominant question. But when they said the class question was the dominant question, they meant white people was the dominant question, because their class struggle revolved around a contest between white workers and white bosses. What we're saying in the final analysis is the real class question is consolidated in the colonial question, because the colonial question, the colonial issue is the determinant issue in history, and that the whole structure of class rule rests upon the pedestal of the oppression of African and other colonized people. No matter how much we are offended by it, the fact is that there are people among us who will sell us out. They will betray us in every instance. They do this because imperialism has constructed a world that gives a tiny section of our population a material interest in the continuing existence of imperialism at the expense of the rest of us. That's just objectively true, and those forces have to go. Let me just say, you know, what we're saying is that we lived a certain way, undoubtedly, as African people on the African continent before we met white people. But imperialism changed that relationship. It changed it for us in Africa. It changed it for white people in Europe and wherever the hell they're located. It changed it for the world. There's a new reality now that has come into existence. And through this reality, what imperialism has done is give a tiny sector of the African population a material stake in the ongoing, in the continuation of this social system. And this is where they get their class definition from. This is how they are defined. They have a material state. It's not just in their brains. There's some people you like to call Uncle Tom's, Uncle Ruckus, or whatever his name is. They act a certain way. They believe in white power and all that. But the thing is that there's a material stake in it for a sector of the population, not just in their heads. They benefit from what happens to the rest of us. And I think that's fundamentally important for us to understand, that they set up these relationships, they construct these relationships, they benefit from it, and they will always be on the other side as a class. Doesn't mean that individuals among them cannot exercise free will and abandon the interests of the petty bourgeoisie and unite with the interests of the working class, but as a social force, in every instance, that class will betray us. So we say that, this is something that we've had a real hard time dealing with as African people, partially because of what white people and so-called communists do by raising the so-called class question in a fashion that liquidates the struggle of black people as a whole people. And so Africans reject that and don't understand any other place to go. And it confuses us in terms of the relationship that we have inside our own community. So we don't recognize Mobutu when we see him, and we don't recognize people right there in our own communities where we live when they see them, and they work for the other side, but they black just like us. You understand? And see the melanin? I mean, don't give that up, because there's some benefit from that, guys, that are coming from African internationalists. But the point is, because we're taking the melanin back, you understand, that they use it, you know, like against the revolution. So we say that African internationalism is the worldview of our party. We understand how imperialism was constructed. We understand that there is a dialectical relationship between the theft of our resources and the wealth of Europe and North America. And this is the science that I'm talking about, because Pan-Africanist doesn't require a scientific explanation. Reality is, we just black. You understand? It doesn't require scientific, doesn't require any of that. Don't have to explain how this thing came into being. In fact, if you're an imperialist, if you're a capitalist or leaning in that direction, you don't want to understand exactly how it came. You want to mystify this question. You want this question to be obscured. You want it to be based on the fact that white people are inherently evil and black people are inherently good and this kind of stuff. And that obscures actual material relationships that exist in the world. And we got to understand how this thing works so that we can get a grip on it and overturn this oppression. Because how do you know who your enemy is before he acts like it? You understand what I'm saying? We're saying there's a certain way that you can begin to understand this, and it's not just enough to say that they're white. It's not enough for a number of reasons, because anyway, I'm not trying to go there right now. We'll just deal with this moving forward. So freedom is not something you can get through parliamentary decree. We have to break this relationship with imperialism as a condition of being free. African internationalism recognizes the existence of class and the fact that the neo-colonialists must be overthrown. The neo-colonialists must be overthrown. I remember being in a meeting in Paris, France in 1983 with Africans from various places, many of whom were from Senegal, some of whom. And I remember this African woman who stood up in the meeting, and she said that the neo-colonialists must not only be destroyed, they must be destroyed physically. I mean, she understood the question in a deep and profound way, just in terms of what it means for the misery of our people. And there are people who are standing up talking about how we just have to give them a chance and help them to understand. No, the neo-colonialists must be overthrown. Yeah. It's not an abstract question that we're talking about. We're talking about millions of people dying. So we say that it recognizes that our freedom is not going to come as a consequence of independent leaders getting together and agreeing to unite Africa. The African petty bourgeoisie has a stake in Africa continuing to exist more or less as it does today. The African petty bourgeoisie has a problem conceiving of an Africa without borders, because the borders facilitate their own material interests. To the extent that the African petty bourgeoisie internationally is beginning to recognize the crisis of imperialism, it is seeking ways to benefit from economically targeting the African market made up of a billion African people. Some of them do it wearing dashikis. Some of them do it in suits and ties. They are all Pan-Africanists. And they are Pan-Africanists now who, because of the influence of China, they will talk bad about the white man. They will talk bad about how the imperialists just such and such and such. We've seen that happen even by Yahya in Gambia. This you know, horrible cretin. They can talk plenty bad about the white man now, but they're going to they still have imperialist domination, imperialist rule over our people, and still enjoy the same social system that prevailed before. Just to say, and this is one of the problems that we had with even Comandante Chavez of Venezuela, who moving, and he's doing a good deed because he's bringing certain relationships to Africa for their production. But what Africa? For the Africa of the neo-colonialists, not the Africans of the African working class who have not yet achieved power. Chavez would do his best work by doing what? Helping to revolutionary organizations who are trying to overthrow these people he's trying to get resources to now. But if he doesn't do that, he facilitates the legitimacy and capability of a neo-colonial force that's there for the purpose of extracting value from the African masses of our people. Just to say we are Pan-Africanists does not address our struggle in the era of imperialism and crisis. We must mobilize the African working class in alliance with the poor peasantry to overthrow our oppressors. It's not good enough to say all Africans unite. We have to say that we want a united and liberated Africa under the leadership of the African working class and poor peasantry. We also believe that socialism, the early stage of communism, is that point when the state becomes the workers in arms. As internationalists, we must fight for this objective. We also believe that for Africa and African people to be free, we must build a single organization like the one that Garvey built. We won't be free with an organization or a bunch of organizations of people around the world who call themselves Pan-Africanists. We must have a single organization with a single philosophy. People move and work very hard to obscure the contradictions or the difference between Garvey and Du Bois. the Pan-Africanists have come up with a thing that they say, here are all the Pan-Africanists, and then they put Du Bois and Garvey. Garvey was not a Pan-Africanist. The Pan-Africanist movement was created to destroy Garvey. And I think that's something that, you know, we should be extremely clear about. And the other thing about Pan-Africanists that's notable, first of all, by Garvey, Du Bois, I don't know of a single instance where Du Bois was organizing to seize power of all of Africa. I don't know a single instance where Du Bois said Africa is for Africans, those at home and those abroad. I don't know a single Pan-Africanist movement today that is talking about destroying the borders and actually trying to implement that through creating structures and organizations and a revolutionary movement, a party to do that. All of them are satisfied with being Pan-Africanists wherever the hell they are. So you got an American Pan-Africanist, and you got a Gambian Pan-Africanist, and you got all these Pan-Africanists all around there with no objective except to reproduce themselves and to build themselves. And that's what we've seen about Pan-Africanism. So we say that Pan-Africanists, we say that that we also believe that socialism, early stages of communism, is that point where the state becomes the workers in arms. As internationalists, we must fight for this objective. We also believe that for Africa and African people to be free, we must build a single organization like the one that Garvey built. We won't be free with an organization or a bunch of people around the world who call themselves Pan-Africanists. We must have a single organization with a single philosophy. Pan-Africanism, either we're capitalists or we're communists. We say socialists, it makes people feel better to say socialists. Pan-Africanists have won power in Africa. But once you get power in an imperialist defined territory, it defines your relationship to the rest of the world. The political economy organized by imperialism gives you a stake in the continuing existence of that territory as it is defined. We have to build an organization that from the beginning has a strategy to destroy all those borders and to build a liberated Africa. This must be an organization of African forces from throughout the world. It must extend from the U.S. to Haiti, to Morocco, to Ethiopia, to Namibia. It has to have a comprehensive approach so that every effort made towards freedom in the whole world by African people facilitates the liberation and unification of Africa under the leadership of the African working class and poor peasantry. Africans everywhere need to be brought to the consciousness that the struggle for African liberation anywhere in the world, objectively speaking, is a part of the effort to unify and liberate Africa. You cannot do that if every group in every country is struggling on its own. You have got to build an organization like Garvey had, one organization with one leadership, one command structure, struggling to make it happen. That organization is the African Socialist International. Uhuru. Yeah. So I want to really open it up, comrade. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Do what you
want. Comrades, before we go into the question and answer, I just want to do one more roll call. For those of you who have not been in a roll call, it's important for us to get everybody's name. So right now we have Devon Kennedy, Aida Elizabeth Bakery. If you don't hear your name, please let me know quickly so that we can expedite this process. Bakery, Lisa, Janice, Stephanie, Mike Love, Ruby, Ali, Ferdoja, Kitty, Ghazi, Ona, Maureen, Unique, Daphne, Lydia, Sean, K-Pen, Achille, Star, Pete, Luazi, and I know there were a lot of people that came on, so can you quickly tell me who you are?
Diane.
Charmaine.
Cornell Jamal.
Oh, Jordan's mother.
Angela.
Diane.
John.
Fofi.
Anybody after Fofi?
Jawara.
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 Uhuru.
Okay. Okay. Will
Lockett.
Will. Anybody else after Will?
Angela.
Angela. Anybody after Angela? Okay, so I will do it one more time at the end. Just it's so important for us to get everybody that's on. Okay.
Well, it's question and answer time. I'm gonna let Sherman take it over from here. But,
yeah, what I would like to do is, first of all, before we get into questions and answers, that Comrade Louisa Kinshasa, who is the Secretary General of the African Socialist International, and who is responsible for so much of the work that we're doing to build the ASI, who just got back from South Africa, Azania, as a part of that process. He's on with us now, and I'm happy to know that he's here. And I wanted to know, Louise, if there's anything that you wanted to contribute to the discussion before we move, before we go further into questions and answers. Did you hear me, Louise? How's Louise?
Are you on mute, Louise?
Yes, I was on mute.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
Yes, can now.
Well, you can hear me.
Yes, Louise.
Oh, yeah, all right. I just want to say first that this was a brilliant, with a massive V. You know, I don't have to say it. It's just a brilliant, political education.
Yes.
And I'm sad, of course, because I have not mobilized a lot of people to be able to listen to that. Because this is something, if you miss it, you need to catch up and listen to this. It really lays out in the best possible way the history of a struggle between African internationalism and Pan-Africanism. And I'll make sure people who are based here, or are based basically, they catch up with this speech. They need to listen to it. I don't have much to add as such. Just one thing, I know that Pan-Africanism, since they use everything they can use to hide the class question, these days they go a lot in Egypt. They have brought what they call Mahat, some principle that's supposed to say they got it from Egypt, therefore that's pure African, and that liquidated the class question completely. So they're hiding beyond that. You see a lot of people that might not say they're Pan-Africans, but I say they are following Mahat principle. That's basically these were one type of a Pan-Africanist we have to deal with today. And you know, as I said, I don't have much to say, you know, so I appreciate it, basically, the political education, and I think we just have to prevent them from hiding from Egypt. Egypt was a place of science, and I suspect one of the reasons that power collapsed, I think the struggle between idealists and the materialists was a constant struggle. And I think the idealist ruling class in Egypt, or that sector of the ruling class, basically, was unable to, had no vision, basically, maybe to protect Egypt. You know, you have to see the historical circumstances, but it points to something like that. And so it's more opportunity to destroy philosophical idealists that were hiding behind the math principles and raise the materials content by Egyptian civilization. And I think all African Socialist International can definitely be the basis, African International can be the basis to resurrect that. It's the road to bring science to Africa. It's the road to revolution, which is the road to African internationalism. So that's the only thing I could say, Chairman. So to listen to the discussion and
I really appreciate that intervention, because a part of, you know, what people like to do is to talk about history again separate from the reality that exist at a particular moment and time. And Africans experience life one way before the advent of the imperialism that gave birth to capitalism. And at the point that imperialism gave birth to capitalism, the point where slavery and brigandage and colonialism fed all this huge concentration of wealth and labor into Europe and to the white world, it transformed the whole world. And it created a whole different kind of relationship. So the world that we're fighting in today is a world that is dominated by the existence of capitalism, that as a social system, as a world system that came into existence from imperialism. So the relationship that people in Egypt may have had at one time with each other, or the relationship that Africans may have had at one time with each other, is different now. And it is informed by a different relationship. And that relationship essentially is the emergence of white power as capitalism in the world. So we can't free ourselves by going back to a pre-capitalist principle. You may be able to go back to a pre-capitalist kind of existence once capitalism is destroyed, but to get to the destruction of capitalism requires us to fight the system as it exists today, and that is the capitalist system. And that capitalist system has introduced serious class contradictions and class interests into the African world. That's the point that I would make. I think it's really important to recognize what Comrade Louise said. So can we open it up for further discussion? Uhuru.
Uhuru.
Yes. I'd introduce yourself, please.
Really appreciate you. Bakri from Oakland, California.
Go ahead, Bakri.
The discussion, because it really opens up the class question, and that is something I think is fundamentally important as African workers to understand. Not just in the context of the African petty bourgeoisie, but in the context of, you know, like you say, everything is influenced by the bourgeoisie in terms of the TV, the movies, the church, everything we do, and it's a constant struggle to deal with this whole class question. But when put in the context of African internationalism, it just, to me, it says it all. It just puts it in a context that is really helpful to move this process forward for Africans to struggle for their freedom in the best kind of way. It just takes away the muddying of the water. It gets clarity and understanding where it helps you to see where it is you're going and why you need to get there.
Uhuru.
Uhuru.
Anyone else? I know there's some more opinions out there.
Somebody might be on mute.
I assume
you can now unmute. No, well, no. No, only unmute when you're going to speak. Let me retract that.
Uhuru, Chairman.
Yes, Comrade Ghazi.
I don't know if I have a question or comment, but
go ahead, Ghazi. Yeah, you can go ahead.
So, like when we talk about, a lot of times when, you know, we make videos and stuff and put stuff out there about Africa, or speak about Africa, a lot of these Africans come out, these young Africans, they're like, oh, well, you can't talk about Africa like that because Africa's, you know, large and 54 different countries and, you know, 200 ethnicities and da 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 da. And it's like, I don't know what to say about that. I'm trying to hurt feelings. But, yeah.
Well, Africa is defined today in terms of its borders and the so-called 54 different countries. These are artificial entities that were created by white people. And there are all these ethnicities. The fact that ethnicity plays an important role is because most of the production that has happened in different societies revolve first around ethnic groups, families and stuff like that, and larger ethnic groups. And that's where most of the economic life originates. And that's how we learn to appreciate and love and care for each other. And that influences a lot. But the thing is that the existence of the borders where that not only constricts economic development, but it makes it impossible for us to have economic development beyond those borders with each other. And the borders facilitate greater relationship with white people, white countries, white power than it does between Africans ourselves. So the ethnics continue to have this outsized significance, where they would dissipate in terms of the crucial significance if Africa were united. If the borders come down and production begins to happen throughout the continent of Africa and all African economy, then ethnicity begins to lose the crucial kind of significance that it has. I'm not sure if I'm clear on that. Even language begins to change because you now have an all African economy, and language is a function of production. It is that which facilitates people's ability to come together to work to produce what we need to live. And if you got production happening within these tiny borders forever, so that they never develop for Africa, even in Ghana, for example, even in one of these small territories, the production that happens there does not facilitate the needs of African people in Ghana up there. It goes someplace else. So the ethnic groups still trying to survive and live as little tiny groups within this artificial economy that has been created to extract value and take it out to the world. And so it continues to have that kind of significance. In Ghana, for example, I hear a common complaint from African people that the government doesn't do anything to create jobs. So we have to create our own jobs. What does that mean? It means families get together, they make bread, they sell it on the streets, they do whatever they can to try to survive, and it continues to give greater significance to ethnicity than it does to the total African nation. So the development and consolidation of African nations is frustrated by the existence of these borders, which enhance the significance of these of so-called ethnicity. Doesn't mean that ethnics will disappear automatically, but they won't be the central feature. Doesn't mean that people still, I love the way them cats dance, you know, like in this part of Africa. It's the way in the US where we've seen a real assault on the predominance of ethnicity among African people. I mean, for example, I'm sitting in a room right now with African people whose parents were born in different parts of the African world. But the ethnic thing doesn't predominate. Why doesn't it predominate? You know, is there some magic that happens to when you come to white people's country? It doesn't predominate because the African culture impacts is the defining culture on this continent. You know, it's just not called African culture. I hear stuff like jazz is the only American music produced. What the hell are you talking about jazz being? It's disappeared once it gets here, but we're all Africans, continue to be Africans. And that's the reality that awaits Africa. These borders come down, economic activity becomes something that involves African people as a whole. Ethnicity as a feature loses its significance. And even though people are gonna still like the way, as a sister I met from Kenya years ago, she said that in Kenya, they say soul brother, talking about African people who live in this country, walk like Maasai. You understand? So I might like the way the Maasai walk, I still am not going to take that away from it. But it won't have the kind of significance it does today. I don't know if that helps. Yeah. Uhuru. Anybody else?
Hello, Jim.
Yes, come in.
Yeah, I just like to make a comment on
this is a comment, K. Fing in Houston. Go ahead, K. Fing.
With regard to African nationalism. And what's happening in the world. And because it seems quite clear, if we're not talking about the destruction of capitalism, then we might as well join the Democratic Party.
Yeah.
I think the question becomes clear when we look at places like China, who did make people revolution, like in Cuba, like you raised the question of survivors, committing resources to neo-colonialist dogs who are murdering our people as this meeting here goes on. How do we explain the fact that that Raul Castro you know, a greeted this damn pope like he was some a real person of change. But on the other hand, we see him going to Africa, bourgeois ideology, like you were saying at the beginning of the meeting. Look at what happened to our movements and Mozambique, Angola, in Zimbabwe, with respect, I think, Ben Africanists led all of those struggles, and right now, everybody's fighting for their own a little piece of the pie. So, you know, I really think that this question of Pan Africanism versus African nationalism is key to the liberation of the whole world.
Yes.
I know in 209, Louise, Comrade Louise, has done an excellent on Pan Africanism versus African nationalism. That it's in the Vernon Spear. It's on the Hulu for all who want to look at that piece, but that's the Vernon Spear that we took to Sierra Leone and finished in Sierra Leone. So it is a continuous struggle. And it seems to me that right now we're winning because we're in place. I think this trip over to South Africa in February is going to make all the difference in the world in terms of standing solidly, you know, in an industrialized sector of Africa, thousand people socialist party, African nationalism. So, you know, the commitment is to destroy capitalism. That's the trajectory. And that's the correct trajectory.
Uhuru, comrade. Uhuru. Anybody else? Comrade Gaida.
Uhuru, Chairman. I just think that this is such an excellent piece. And in every period of the work, I mean, this has been out for a while in terms of your development of this whole understanding. And I think this is the question of this period right now. In every period, you know, you see certain questions come to the top. And I think the whole question of philosophy that you started out with is so important, you know, especially now when people are in the streets seeking answers, and we see, you know, neocolonialism, how it's jumping in front, attempting to jump in front, and people need to be armed with this question. Neocolonialism, you know, Pan-Africanism is neocolonialism.
It is.
That's it, and we have to now begin to put it out like that. It has to be sharp, because I believe that the contradictions are sharp, you know, the stakes are sharp, you know, and I just believe that we need to have a whole explosion of African internationalism forums, discussion. We need to, this is the question. This answers to what end? We're asking it in all kinds of different ways, but I just think that this is so important, you know, and the whole appreciation for African work, you know, working class and poor Africans to have our own philosophy. I think this is such a powerful and, you know, study that we're doing. And this question here and the way it's been developed in years to come is going to be key to the liberation of African people is now, but I'm saying that this is going to be the pivotal question, you know, because we have answered it. And the question of having to lose all our leaders, you know, Kwame Nkrumah, Lumumba, all of that, you know, we cannot allow that to happen. In this period, we have to arm the people, and to arm them is to be able to understand our own philosophy. And African internationalism, is it? That's the thing that means freedom for African people. So
uh-huh.
I just really appreciate it. This is exciting.
You know, on the last page of this discussion, we say that the African People's Socialist Party has called for the creation of dual power within the United States as a strategic objective for winning liberation. This tool of power will transform every oppressed community within the domestic African colony. Am I reading the same thing that you have?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
No.
I'm not reading the same thing you have.
Same.
Okay. All right. I'm confused because I got two different pieces. That's on 58, right?
58.
Yeah. That's what I was reading. Yeah. Okay. That's the what?
Well, the previous,
it's from the previous. Chapter. Okay, I see what that. All right, I got you. Okay, I don't need to read that. Yeah, I don't need to read that. But it's important, you know, I mean, just in terms.
Before we close out, we're still, at least my computer, I'm receiving the study sideways.
That's what happened with me too. But I think there's a way you can turn it or something, but it was difficult for me. Yeah, it can be. Yeah, because I got it sideways and couldn't use it on my iPad. Yeah. All right. Anybody else? Comrades on the study? I can't believe it.
Yeah.
I can't believe it. I can't believe that.
Oh, yeah.
Sean, you there from San Bernardino? San what? San Bruno? San Bruno. You there from
San? Yeah, I'm here.
Okay.
Milk, okay, man.
So, anything, Sean?
Actually, I'm just really soaking it all in.
Okay.
I'm kind of like at work, so I was
getting
out.
Gotcha.
Great job.
Okay. Elizabeth, anything?
Are you mute? Are you muted?
Sister Akile, anything? Uhuru.
I mean, it's a great study as always, and I mean, I learned new things, but it's just you know, the more information about it, because I already come in with a certain understanding, but you know, I leave just being more knowledgeable and confident that I can you know, teach and lead, you know, those who follow me. So,
Uhuru.
Yeah, thank you.
Uhuru. I like that. Teach those who follow me. Right on. Splendid. Yeah. Anybody on the call? Come on, Penny Hans.
Uhuru.
Uhuru, yes, Foots.
It's 4 feet.
Yes, 4 feet deep.
Chairman, I like it. I was speaking on my show one night, and it sounded like I was regurgitating what you've been teaching. And I appreciate it because it makes me relevant when people ask about the organization. And I appreciate that, and I continue to learn. Uhuru.
Uhuru,
Chairman.
Yes. Who is this?
This is Herdosha.
Yes, come on, Herdosha.
Yeah, I was watching through YouTube.
Okay.
I had to call. But I wanted to call because I really appreciate the study. I remember listening before about Pan-African versus African Internationalist. And I just think that it's really important for us to really grasp this because you can see it. I was, you know, manifesting in the world. I was just spending some time in Chicago, and I don't know if the people were calling themselves Pan-African, but you know, it's just that class question that's always getting in an arena with the oppressor to decide what the, like, how we supposed to resist. And they will always constantly sell us out. And that's why it's so important for the working class, the poor, to really lead the movement, you know, to really lead the struggle, because it speaks to all Africa. It speaks to all Africans, continent and here in the States. And there's no way for us to go around and save a percentage of African people. You know, I believe, you know, I really truly believe in African internationalism, and I believe that it is to what end. It speaks to self-governance.
Mm-hmm.
And so I just really appreciate this. I just really appreciate the study to deepen that whole question. We have a group here that call themselves Pan-African and they, I think they consider themselves some revolutionary organization. And so you have all these different forms of Pan-African, and that's the problem. It's only one African International. It's one stand.
That's,
you know,
right.
Our people right now need to have a solid, you know, kind of stance. Not just this lukewarm, you know, you can believe this or you can believe that, you know, even though people like to, that makes them feel comfortable, but we need to get uncomfortable, because being oppressed is embarrassing and we should want out of it, and it's not going to take, you know, well, you can think whatever you want. No, we want to be free. So I just really appreciate it, Chairman.
Uhuru. Is George's mother still on? George's mother, did we pass muster? Is that Charmaine. Sister Charmaine? Are you there?
On mute.
Hold on, K-Fing. Hold on, K-Fing. Go ahead, Sister Charmaine.
I'm here. It was very informative.
Okay. I'm glad you're there. Glad you're there. Where are you located?
South Bend, Indiana.
Oh, South Bend. All right. Yeah. Well, it's good to hear from you. Good that you are here. And I hope you, you know, catch a ride.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Uhuru. K-Fing, before I call.
Uhuru, yeah. I want to make this brief comment based on the comments that Adosia made and that Achille made. And those comments were based in their quest for knowledge. And trust me, I remember Jim O'Malley as a young man who used to know where he went. He took suitcases of books. My point is that the networks for good reason to try to search out so we can learn what it took to make the African Revolution. So I'm suggesting, and we learned everything that we got our hands on.
That's right.
What we didn't have at that point was General O'Malley's writings like they were accumulated over the past 40, 50 years. So
yeah.
I'm suggesting that everybody on this call look at the books he's written, get them all put into your collection, because listen, you can learn what General Miles is teaching off of Facebook. The time that you would spend, you know, just give yourself an hour or so a day, you know, reading one of his works, and it will send you to other works, because unless we've actually got a deep understanding of the whole revolutionary process, then we have a tendency to fall off the process. So my point being, go to Mr. Chairman's words and all, you know, and then I'm going to lose the material you might think you need to read, study, you know, our young people are on the right track. And those who are killing you, raise the right question. So let's take it forward.
Hold on. I'm going to call Ghazi, but I want to say that the thing that's also important about Herdosia and Achille's interventions is that it's clear that they recognize that African internationalists have a responsibility to govern. Mm-hmm. And they talk about leading people. And so this is not just some hypothetical abstract discussion that we have. And we're talking about arming people to actually have to capture and exercise power, and recognizing that each of us has a responsibility to take a role in that. Comrade Ghazi Uhuru.
Hello, Chairman. Yeah. I just wanted to thank you for really introducing us to Garvey, because, you know, I've read a lot about him, heard a lot about him, and it just becomes, after a point, it just becomes repetitive. The things that you hear, and it doesn't really, like you said, really grasp who he was and the things that he did and how he really impacted the world, impacted, you know, African people all over the world and connected us, you know, back to our homeland and our siblings. And even beyond that, seeing like how he saw the class question and these other people come to him for leadership, you know, these other revolutionaries come to him for leadership is just powerful and awing and really empowering.
Yeah.
Also, the whole thing of a lot of the times when we sum these individuals up in history and when it's not so nice summations, you know, these sometimes you get people's reactionary stance of, oh, division, you're dividing us, we must be all one black people, And it's like, of course we want to divide ourselves from the state and show who's for the state, who's for imperialism, who's for colonialism, who's against it. We have to, you know, it's not dividing for dividing sake, because you have so many people dividing just for dividing sake. And, you know, at any time you can cross that line and join, you know, the people at any time. We're not saying, you know, this is the line and you can never cross. At any time you can throw away, you know, your bourgeoisie stance and come over to the right side of the question. And this is just great because Pan-Africanism, of course, is growing, but it's, I think it's growing in this time because people don't understand what it means.
Mm-hmm.
And so they latch onto it because it's the only thing that's out there.
Mm-hmm.
Even like the flag that, you know, it's behind you,
mm-hmm.
People call it the Pan-African flag when that's not what it's called. And to know that, you know, Garvey's the one that, you know, came up with creating the flag,
mm-hmm.
and that the Pan-African movement was created to destroy Garvey's
mm-hmm.
movement, is just insane that, you know, in this year, after all this time, that it's called, you know, the Pan-African flag. And I've never seen a group of people that are vigorously fighting against that and vigorously fighting for Garvey, not even the Garveyites, not even the people
yeah.
that say they're part of the UNIA and all this
yeah.
other kind of nonsense.
Yeah.
It's like no one's really fighting for what he fought for, and people are letting everyone just take pieces of the things that he put out there and put their name on it.
Yeah.
I just really want to thank you for really arming us to not just fight for Garvey, but to fight for African people and to unite us under African internationalism as the only way towards revolution. Because like as you said, you know, there's no such thing as a Pan-African revolutionary because they don't even talk about the class question. They don't, you know, get organized for imperialism and all these other things. So I just want to thank you, Uhuru.
Uhuru. Some people are African internationalists and call themselves Pan-Africanists because that's the only thing that's out there. Nkrumah started off by saying that the most important thing that influenced him was philosophy and opinions by Marcus Garvey. Marcus Garvey was not a Pan-Africanist. He said he was what? An African fundamentalist. So there was African fundamentalism and there was Pan-Africanism. And African internationalism is African fundamentalism in the 21st century. So, comrades, I really want to express appreciation. I'm hoping that a lot of the people who are on this call will be with us on January 9th here in St. Petersburg, Florida, at our plenary. The plenary is going to be an extraordinarily important event that will help to develop the revolutionary process, the revolutionary movement. One of the things that makes these studies so important and the work that we do so important is that it moves us from this place where people think they're engaging in political education and knowing something because they're reading what is being characterized as black history. In fact, that's what most of the Africans who are demanding that. They want some black history, you know, but history in and of itself won't work for you. You have to have black history that is influenced by historical materialist assessment. And that's what we call African internationalism. So how you understand and interpret that history is crucial. So it's not just having a number of facts, the first black person created this. In fact, there are people who proudly say that how there were two or three black presidents of the United States before Obama, you know, according to something that somebody wrote, that they were really black. So why the hell would we be bragging about having someone presiding over the empire that was responsible for causing so much misery around people around the world? History and facts by themselves don't mean anything. It's how we understand their interpreting this history and analyzing this history. That's the critical thing. And that's what African internationalism is. The utilization of historical dialect and historical materialism to interpret and analyze the reality experienced by African people, and then especially as it relates to the development of capitalism itself. So, is it on you guys?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, hello, everyone. So I just have a few announcements to make before we the meeting's adjourned, the class is adjourned. First and foremost, just like Chairman said, the plenary is coming up January 9th and 10th, so please make sure to register. We currently have almost 40 people on the call and 26 people viewing online currently live. And out of those groups of people, we only have around 16 people that are registered. So we call on you to go on APSPplenary.org right now and register. We have different packets and shirts and hoodies and all great exciting things. Also, we do understand if you cannot make it, please bookmark APSPlenary.org because we will be live streaming there so you can view the plenary as well online. But nothing is greater than being there live where you can ask me questions and talk to people face to face and hopefully join the party if you're not part of the party yet. Next announcement is blackpower96.org. We have a great announcement that we have an angel donor that will be matching anything that we raise. So if you donate, you know, $20, this person's going to donate another $20, so you're really donating $40. So please go to blackpower96.org and support the Black community-owned radio station that we will have here in St. Pete, but we are also going to be live streaming the radio station, so it will be worldwide, and the money that we'll be raising, the resource we'll be raising, will go towards building an application to also get to our youth, because as we know, they view the radio on their phone and listen to music on their phone, so we are in the process of designing an application. Next announcement is the burningspearmarketplace.org. Please go to burningspearmarketplace.org where you can sign up for your newspapers, get books by the chairman and the party, and all different things to further your political education. One more announcement. Next Sunday at 4 p.m. is the world summation of the chair. Last announcement is the APSC plenary is going to be January 11th. And I call on anyone that's in this call that is not part of the African People Socialist Party to go to joinapsp.org to sign up to join the African People Socialist Party. Uhuru, everyone.
Uhuru, one correction. If you want to get your spear, it is burningspearmarketplace.com. That's burningspearmarketplace.com. Uhuru.
Uhuru, you go ahead, come in.
This is Penny of the African People Solidarity Committee, and I just wanted to let people know that the plenary of the African People Solidarity
Committee. Come on, when y'all talk like that, remember how it is when you're not muted and people are talking all into it. That's what you're doing when other people. Go ahead.
The plenary of the African People Solidarity Committee will be Monday, January 11th, and follows on the heels of the 2 days of the party's plenary, January 9th and 10th. And this is where the African People Solidarity Committee and others of us who are part of the strategy of the African People Socialist Party to work in the white communities to bring African internationalism and the fight for reparations and solidarity with the struggle for African liberation to the white community. This is our work, and we will be summing up our work, our year, and the mandates from Chairman O'Malley Chatel on the political report, et cetera. So everybody who is coming to the party's plenary is also welcome to come to the APSC plenary on Monday, January 11th. And you can go to APSCUhuru.org to find out more information. Also, we just wanted to announce or make it more clear that next Sunday at 4 o'clock Eastern, the annual year's summation or world summation of the year will be held by Chairman O'Malley Chatela at the 4 o'clock hour live stream from here in St. Petersburg as part of the final offensive initiative of the party. And that will be promoted more during this week, but it will be an ability to hear the chairman summing up the political situation and leading into the party's historic plenary of January 9th and 10th.
Uh-huh. So thank you very much, comrades, brothers and sisters. And I think our next study will be African Identity is Key, if I'm not mistaken, and that is taken from what? One Africa, One Nation. And that material will be sent out on when that by Tuesday. You'll have the material for that study. The next study, however, will not be this coming Sunday, but will be when? We'll send that out on Tuesday. We'll send information out on Tuesday with that.
You will have the other study on that Sunday.
The other Sunday is going to be at 4 o'clock.
That's the 27th.
On the 27th. All right. Thank you very much, brothers and sisters and comrades. Uhuru.
Uhuru.